In the extreme south of South America, Argentina has one of the most fertile plains on Earth, a huge flatland that captivates adventurers, the Pampas. It has been only a century since the Pampas are used for farming and livestock, and it's Argentina's most important natural resource. Since the beginning of the 90s, Argentine agriculture has incorporated new technology, which reduced cost and increased production. Each year, crops are larger, and the production turnover exceeds the volume of the previous season, increasing the country's profits from these exported products. This increase in production is based on the cropping of genetically modified soya. Soya increases production, but it has serious negative effects. The monoculture of soya results in millionaire losses as to the fertility of the soil, the extinction of basic food products, and a massive environmental contamination. In addition, as the cultivated areas of soya grow, labor resources disappear. Thus, unemployment, hunger, and poverty increase. Argentina produces enough soya to feed 100 million people. In spite of this, half of the population of 35 million inhabitants lives under the poverty line, without access to even a basic diet. Throughout the 20th century, the Argentine Pampas sustained a farming and livestock production of top quality products, feeding its population and supplying the markets worldwide. The need of rural workers promoted the settlement of millions of immigrants who came from Europe seeking peace and prosperity. The territory was very quickly inhabited with settlers who founded new villages and communities, which resulted in a demographic explosion boosted by the brand new railway lane. The profits from the farming and livestock production were assigned to a growing industry, expanding Argentina's economy. Year after year, the Pampas region produced larger crops of good and assorted food, in a growth spiral that seemed to have no end. And this is how the region became known as the granary of the world.
El granero del mundo, entendido como el país que provee de fibras, de granos, de carnes, a grandes o a muchas poblaciones a escala global.
In the last 30 years, the Argentine economic policy gave a 100-degree turn, and the country suffered a serious transformation. The production and development policies were ousted, giving way to an economy based mainly on financial speculation. This trend got worse in the decade of the 90s. The state stopped controlling and regulating the economy, so the large foreign companies were free to make profits of their own. With a massive industrial shutdown, the country sunk into its worst recession ever seen. Today, poverty surpasses 50% of the population, and 1 out of 4 Argentines is jobless. Agriculture was also a victim of this process. Good and varied food is no longer produced. Instead, soya and other low-cost raw materials are cropped for the first world. The corporate interests, the state's absence, and the producer's ambition destroyed the balanced production that employed laborers. That country, which at the turn of the 20th century offered work and food to thousands of immigrants, moved into the 21st century marked by hunger.
En este momento la Argentina no puede alimentar a su propia población, ni siquiera con los alimentos básicos, porque se convirtió casi exclusivamente en un enclave generador de productos de exportación que, por supuesto, afectan a su soberanía alimentaria.
In 1970, soya crops represented less than 1% of Argentina's agricultural turnover. The area cultivated with soya increased gradually until 1996, when the genetically modified soya from the USA was placed in the market. The genetic alterations of transgenic soya, the RR soya, have made it resistant to a herbicide called glyphosate, mostly known commercially under the trademark Roundup. Glyphosate is a plant poison that kills most species, including non-transgenic soya. But there are a few plant species and bacteria naturally resistant to glyphosate. After isolating the resistant gene of the plants, scientists introduced it into the soya by genetic engineering, creating the transgenic soya resistant to the herbicide. Thus, when glyphosate is applied, all the plants except the transgenic soya die, and this is very useful for weed control.
Aparentemente, a simple vista, es exactamente la misma. La soja sigue siendo la misma, pero usted le tira con el balde de glifosato y no la mata. Este es algo espectacular, ¿no?
Hugo Nucciari has been an agriculturist for around 50 years. All his life, he has updated himself to increase production and to be adapted to new technologies. This spring, Hugo Nucciari and his neighbors are sowing soya on their fields in hope of a good harvest. Farmers have massively adopted transgenic soya because it is cheaper to grow than other products and the yield is higher. Besides, it requires minimum care, fumigation, and glyphosate, and the use of other poisons when plagues attack the crops. Transgenic soya and the herbicide glyphosate constitute together a very profitable production pack.
Tanto la soja como el herbicida fueron, invenciones o son patentes de una compañía internacional que es Monsanto, y que a su vez le cede o le comercializa la patente a nivel mundial. Ese es el paquete, si se quiere, que ha logrado entrar en la Argentina de la mano de otro proceso muy importante, que es la siembra directa.
The no-tillage system produced a revolution among agriculturalists, and it was essential to the expansion of soya. With no tillage, the soil is plowed up, and the seed is introduced over the dry remains of the previous crop, without stirring the soil. All the work is done in only one pass with a machine, simplifying the agricultural tasks.
Prácticamente de lo que antes teníamos una playa de herramientas para trabajar el suelo, ahora eso lo reemplazamos con un fumigador y una sembradora, y nada más, digamos.
Just like the transgenic soya, the no-tillage system also contributes in the profits, because working the soil less means employing less manpower and using less fuel.
En relación, por ejemplo, al cultivo convencional a través de la maquinaria agrícola, donde se consumía millones de litros de gasoil, empezamos a sacar la cuenta que era pero tremendamente beneficioso hacer siembra directa con glifosato. Hoy, con la soja transgénica, siembre torcido, derecho, siembre redondo, después le manda el avión y punto.
Out of the last 9 crops Hugo Nucciari has sowed in his farm, 6 were transgenic soya, and most agriculturalists did the same. In 7 years, the area sowed with transgenic soya has increased 16 times, from 800,000 hectares to over 13 million. Argentina is the second world producer after the USA, and half of its agricultural production consists in transgenic soya. Nearly all the soya produced in Argentina is exported to first world countries as raw industrial material and fodder. 30% is exported as grain. The other 70% produces oil and byproducts used as animal food mainly in Europe. Transgenic soya is Argentina's main export product.
La Argentina salta en el mercado exportador, por lo menos en commodities, y nos transformamos de un país productor de alimentos sanos, de alimentos ricos, la famosa granja del mundo, el país de las vacas y las mieses, nos transformamos en un país exportador de commodities, de piensos, de forrajes para los animales de Europa. O sea, nosotros le facilitamos los piensos a aquellos países que ahora fabrican la proteína que nosotros producíamos antes. Y todo esto va a permitir una verdadera revolución en el campo de la producción. Una revolución que nos hunde, porque es una revolución de los commodities.
While some agriculturalists make big money with soya, others are forced out of the business, which causes instant social problems. No tillage of soya reduces the agriculturalist's work, but it requires special state-of-the-art machinery. Thus, it is difficult to afford one of these machines. It requires a large cultivated area to afford one. And each year, bigger and faster machines that save time and reduce the number of workers needed are launched into the market. The agriculturalists with small farms do not earn enough to produce soya on a large scale and have to end up renting or selling their land to the big soya farmers.
Y esto genera una expulsión de pequeños propietarios y una desertificación del agro, digamos. El agro va quedando con pocas personas encargadas de manejar las cosechadoras, los tractores, las trilladoras. Donde antes había un ejército de personas, ahora hay muy pocas operando.
From 1990 to 2002, 60,000 mid and small-sized farms disappeared, with an average of 12 properties shutting down each day. When orchards and farms shut down, a wide variety of basic food is no longer produced, from legumes and vegetables to high-quality cereals and animal products. The production of cow milk is one of the sectors most affected by the progress of soya. Many milk producers have had to shut down their dairy farms because it is more profitable to rent the land to grow soya. In these last 2 years, thousands of dairy farms had to shut down in Argentina. Less quality food is produced, and in turn, transgenic soya generates a huge unemployment, as very little manpower is needed to sow and harvest this soya, and because it also destroys other productions that used to create jobs. The cotton region in the north of Argentina was an unemployment resource for thousands of families in the manual harvesting season. But cotton producers turned to sowing transgenic soya, and the cotton production fell by 80%. As cotton disappeared, harvesters lost their jobs and concentrated in the small villages. So today in these small communities that host cotton workers, 6 out of 10 adults are jobless. Aníbal Cabral lives with his wife and children in a small cotton district in the north of Argentina. Like his neighbors, he has been jobless for 3 years, ever since the cotton production ceased.
Estamos viviendo en la miseria por culpa que no hay algodón. Y la soja no nos sirve a nosotros por el asunto que al ver soja, nosotros no, el color nosotros no da ni una salida de trabajo a nosotros. Y la cantidad de soja que hay es solamente ganancia para el colono. Los gringos la siembran directa, le echan un veneno que es para el pasto y está todo, o sea que todo es sobre máquina. Hacen todas las cosas sobre maquinaria. Y nosotros como obreros no tenemos ni una entrada en esos trabajos, como así. Como para nosotros poder sustentar o ganar algo para el puchero, como así, comúnmente acabamos de recibir.
To make ends meet, Aníbal Cabral and his neighbors depend on a government aid of 150 pesos, around $50 they receive each month. This money helps, but he is very far from covering his family's needs. Aníbal Cabral and his neighbors do not want to live on welfare. They want to work in the fields.
Dije, yo tengo 5 chicos y tengo mi esposa, soy yo, y con 150, ¿qué vamos a vivir? No vivimos. Si con los 150 comemos 10 días y después los otros 20 días que falta, ¿qué comemos? Y no hay una changa. Nosotros nos sentimos humillados muchas veces por eso, porque no nos ganamos dignamente el pan como nosotros nos ganábamos antes. Porque nosotros somos gente que estamos acostumbrados de trabajar y poner el lomo siempre.
Hundreds of thousands of families were forced to leave their fields they had always lived on. And in the coming years, the number of rural workers losing their jobs will keep on rising. People ousted from the countryside cannot get new jobs. The Argentine industry was devastated during the 1990s. And there is no proper planning to provide work for the jobless in the agricultural sector.
El problema de la Argentina es que en la medida que solo hubo producción de soja o de alguna materia prima, lo que tenemos es expulsión de personas del suelo, desertificación agraria, con un fenómeno de concentración sobre las grandes urbes.
The suburbs of the big cities witness the growing number of slums, more and more populated day by day by the hungry and the poor.
La opinión pública concentrada en las grandes ciudades ha perdido la dimensión del país real, entonces los problemas que se plantean sobre todo desde sectores de izquierda intelectual son problemas de iniquidad social, o sea, se lo ve como un problema de injusticia, que no digo que no lo haya, sino que además de la injusticia de que unos ganen mucho y otros vivan en la indigencia, lo que hay que desmontar es la fábrica de la pobreza. Y la fábrica que produce pobres está en el modelo rural.
The Argentine rural model not only threatens its population's social safety, but also endangers its own future. Due to the soya crops, the agricultural lands in Argentina are rapidly losing their fertility. Rotation is one of the basic concepts in farming and livestock production. To keep the land fertile, different species of seeds and livestock have to be alternated. Variety enriches the soil and keeps it fertile in the course of time. Sowing a single species dries up the soil, diminishing its fertility as time goes by. The present agricultural system in Argentina is based on the monoculture of soya, and the problems are starting to show up.
Primero nos dijeron que la soja aportaba nitrógeno al suelo, que era bueno porque era una oleaginosa. Pero resulta que lo que descubrimos que no es así, digamos. la soja podrá aportar algo hasta cierto punto, digamos, pero una vez que se logran mejores rindes con variedades buenas, todas esas cosas, en lugar de aportar, le está sacando, y está sacando muchísimo. Nos estamos quedando con el esqueleto del suelo, en realidad.
Many farmers thought that the no-tillage system would solve the problem of deterioration of the soil. When this system is used with rotation of crops, it preserves the soil because the remains of the previous harvest are absorbed as organic material. Some species like sorghum or corn are ideal to rotate crops, because they are rich in vegetable matter, and this is absorbed into the soil. With a monoculture of soya, no tillage loses the qualities that preserve the soil, and it is only good to reduce costs. Soya leaves almost no vegetable residues, so the nutrients of organic matter for the soil are minimum. The monoculture of soya leaves the land bare and unprotected after each harvest. And worse still, to grow ripe soya requires many more nutrients than other crops.
El cultivo de soja en sí mismo es muy demandante, o es un alto extractor, si podemos decirlo así, de nutrientes por unidad o por kilo de grano producido. Si uno lo compara, por ejemplo, con el cultivo de maíz, en realidad las necesidades nutricionales de nitrógeno, fósforo, potasio, azufre y de otros nutrientes de soja son prácticamente del doble de las del cultivo de maíz, ¿no es cierto?
Research shows that the concentration of nutrients fell drastically these last years due to the monoculture of soya.
Buenos días.
Hola.
¿Qué tal? ¿Cómo le va?
Buenos días.
¿Cómo andaste? ¿Bien? Acá traje unas muestras de suelo.
And worse still, some nutrients like phosphorus are not naturally renewable and have to be added to the soil artificially. Recent studies have revealed that in the last 20 years, the amount of phosphorus in the soil decreased severely, and specialists forecast a sad prognosis.
Si uno piensa que los niveles de fósforo, otro nutriente esencial para el crecimiento de las plantas y la producción de las mismas, pasó también de situaciones de 60 partes por millón a niveles actuales que están entre los 10 y 15 partes por millón en ese lapso de 20 años, uno podría pensar o esperar que esta situación no se va a sostener mucho más allá de 15 o 20 años. Es decir, vamos a ir cayendo por una escalera de disminución de la fertilidad de los suelos que en definitiva nos va a llevar a niveles de producción muy, muy bajos si no tomamos las medidas que corresponden.
Besides requiring many nutrients, soya is very efficient at extracting nutrients from the earth. This enables the good use of fields where other products would never grow. As farmers see they get good harvests, they save themselves the cost of adding fertilizers to the soya, so the plant lives exclusively on nutrients it extracts from the soil. In the harvest of 2002, 30 million tons of soya were exported, and the grains used up 900,000 tons of nitrogen, 200,000 tons of phosphorus, and 140,000 tons of sulfur.
Si esas toneladas de nutriente se traducen en equivalente fertilizante, que sería lo que tendríamos que estar aplicando para reponer todos esos nutrientes que se llevaron los granos de soja, estaríamos hablando de un costo aproximado que llegarían a casi 900 millones de dólares. Si tenemos en cuenta que la gran mayoría de los granos de soja se exporta, estaríamos hablando de que exportamos, ¿no es cierto?, en el orden de esos 900 millones de dólares.
In the soya harvest of 2002, around $5 billion were invoiced.
Fíjense que casi un 20% de esos 5.000 millones de dólares que producimos con la cosecha de soja representan lo que le sacamos como nutrientes a nuestro suelo, ¿no es cierto?
The nutrients exported with the harvest are hardly ever replaced. Thus, the Argentine soil is giving away to the business of transgenic soya a subsidy of almost 20% in nutrients. In spite of the harm done to the soil, the crops of transgenic soya increase by almost 1 million hectares a year. Its high yield has even led to sowing on lands not fit for agriculture. The Chaco region up north is one of the environments of greater biodiversity in Argentina. It is full of thick forests that protect many species of the flora and fauna. But the demand for lands to grow soya is destroying this environment fast and affecting the habitat of endangered species, such as the giant armadillo or tatu carreta, the largest armadillo on Earth. Gustavo Porini is a biologist at the Argentine National Fauna Board. He studies and preserves the giant armadillo. In recent years, Gustavo has noticed that the animals have been abandoning their home region.
Es una cueva vieja. Ya hay telas de araña y palos y todo dentro de la cueva. Y pertenece a un tatu carreta. Por lo que podemos ver de las inmediaciones de la cueva, este animal ya no se encuentra en este lugar.
When animals abandon their areas, they are captured by villagers. Many are sold in the black market and others die in captivity. This giant armadillo was rescued from poachers. It was in rehab for 1 month. And it's in good conditions now, but we are not sure that it will survive. Giant armadillos abandon their areas because they no longer have enough space. The demand for land to grow soya destroys their habitat, so they have nowhere to live.
Y le están cerrando el lugar. Y los pocos lugares que le quedan son cada vez menores. Entonces tiene menos posibilidades de elección.
This time, the giant armadillo was lucky. It survived and was taken to the Copo National Park in the core of the Chaco Forest. It will be protected for the coming years. But the giant armadillo and other endangered species will only survive if the forest is preserved, a fact uncertain due to the increasing soya fields.
La principal amenaza que tiene el tatu carreta en estos momentos es la extensión de esta frontera agropecuaria y esta colonización. A mayor cultivo de soja, mayor extensión de las hectáreas de soja, menor proporción de supervivencia, no solo del tatú, de muchas especies, del hábitat directamente.
Though the forest soil is not fit for agriculture, more than 1 million hectares of trees have been cut to sow soya. The effect of soya is devastating. After 5 years of production, the soil deteriorates, loses fertility, and is eroded by wind and water. Deprived from the protection of the trees and overexploited with soya, the lands of the Chaco region are rapidly turning into deserts, and they are no longer useful, neither for agriculture nor to preserve the ruined biodiversity. The monoculture of transgenic soya endangers biodiversity, but its environmental damages go even further. Companies defend transgenic soya, saying that its cropping is positive for the environment because it reduces the number of poisons. But the use of glyphosate on the fields has increased to alarming numbers.
Entre los 90 y principio del 2001 pasamos de un consumo de 1 millón de litros de glifosato a más de 120 millones de litros de glifosato. En términos ambientales, la problemática es bastante compleja porque se está afectando, digamos, un agroecosistema y se está utilizando una alta carga de agroquímico, del mismo tipo de agroquímico, en forma recurrente año a año.
Glyphosate is considered a highly toxic product. But the toxicity research is done mostly by the same company that received the patent, which causes suspicion as to the results published. The study says that glyphosate as a pure drug is hardly toxic. But on crops, a commercial formula is used, mixed with other substances that are toxic, and increase the toxicity of glyphosate. Additionally, recent studies have revealed that some commercial formulas contain less glyphosate than what the labels say, thus increasing the concentration of toxic substances in the formula and worsening the environmental contamination by these products. The massive use of glyphosate contaminates the environment, and even agriculture itself can suffer its negative effects. The constant use of a herbicide like glyphosate on a long-term basis makes some weeds tolerant or resistant to the herbicide.
En los Estados Unidos ya empiezan a aparecer ejemplos de malezas que son tolerantes al herbicida, lo que implica que los productores para lograr un control relativamente bueno tienen que usar mucho más herbicida del que se comenta en los marbetes.
Transgenic soya is resistant to glyphosate, but defenseless against insects. It is attacked by the same plagues of common soya and has to be fumigated with the same pesticides. Additionally, new plagues have appeared. In the stubbles left from the no-till system, certain animals become a problem, like snails and slugs and even pill bugs. To tackle these plagues, new pesticides that were not necessary before must be used. Producing transgenic soya contaminates the environment, diminishes the fertility of the soil, and increases the unemployment of rural workers. Some researchers believe that if it keeps on expanding, the Argentines will suffer more unemployment and more hunger. Hunger is whipping the Argentine people like never before in the last 100 years. Some producer guilds and many government officers thought soya might be the solution to this scourge. At the start of 2002, they implemented a plan to hand out soya beans to community dining centers around the country. Soya has never been part of the traditional diet in Argentina. Now hunger has surpassed traditions, and at the centers, people eat soya many times a week. But the excessive consumption of soya can cause health problems to the poorest. Yolanda Lanche runs a community dining center. She adds soya to the meals as it is harder and harder to get meat and other food products. But Yolanda does not have the minimum elements to properly cook the soya she receives. To be cooked properly, soya beans must boil for over an hour. But gas is very expensive. and at almost all the dining centers, the soya is boiled just for a few minutes. These almost raw beans are then mixed with other food to camouflage their taste.
Si usted no tiene carne, usa soja y se cuenta que está comiendo carne. Por eso yo no lo puedo hacer.
Soya is handed out as a substitute for meat due to its protein content. Nothing is said about the risk of eating it almost raw.
Bueno, la soja tiene algunos elementos que actúan como antinutrientes. Podríamos nombrar la inhibición de la tripsina, y entonces la digestión proteica puede verse interferida por su presencia. El alto contenido de isoflavonas tiene además un alto contenido de fibra y entonces interfiere en la absorción de muchos oligoelementos y minerales, y esto trae como consecuencia un déficit de estos elementos que son imprescindibles para la nutrición.
In the poor districts in Argentina, hunger and malnutrition are daily enemies. For Yolanda Lanche, it is a thrill to feed the children who go to her dining hall. But Yolanda ignores that soda is particularly dangerous for younger children, and it is the younger ones who turn to her most.
Malabsorben nutrientes esenciales, como pueden ser el calcio, el hierro, el zinc, que los necesita para un crecimiento normal. Y por eso los pediatras contraindicamos la soja en menores de 2 años. Y en realidad, lo óptimo sería no darla hasta después de los 5 años, y cuando se administra después de los 5 años, como un alimento más, de la misma manera que uno da lentejas o garbanzos o porotos, ¿no?
The delivery of soya was a success in all the poor districts, and many government officers doubled the bet and promoted all around the country the use of soya processors locally known as mechanical cows. These machines process large amounts of soya beans and extract the juice or soya milk. The mechanical cows are operated by well-intentioned volunteers, but good intentions are not enough to solve the malnutrition caused by this soya juice affecting the children of the community dining centers.
En la población de niños pequeños, si lo que pretendemos es prevenir la desnutrición, lo que no debemos hacer es alimentarlos con jugo de soja en lugar de leche, porque lo que vamos a hacer es provocar desnutrición, porque va a llevar a que estos niños tengan pocas calorías y que tengan déficit de hierro, déficit de calcio, déficit de vitaminas. O sea, no es de ninguna manera un alimento completo.
Claro. Entonces, se lava para sacarle, ¿ves? Que está claro. Toda negra.
Toda sucia con todo lo... Porque viene directamente de la cosecha.
The soya distributed to the dining centers comes straight from the fields. No tests are run to detect residues of glyphosate and other pesticides that remain on the grain after the fumigations. This is yet another risk for the children. A recent study revealed in soybean residues of glyphosate and endosulfan, a dangerous organochlorated insecticide used against certain insects that attack crops.
A pesar de que el glifosato se usa cuando la planta todavía no nació o apenas nacida, y que el endosulfano se usa cuando empieza a florecer o cuando la chaucha está absolutamente cerrada y chica, sin embargo se encontraron residuos dentro del grano, o mejor dicho, en el grano verde, y también en el grano ya maduro o seco, cuando se coseche.
In spite of all these risks, soya is still distributed, and its consumption is highly promoted because producers give it for free.
Frente a la difícil situación por la que pasan las familias argentinas para poder adquirir sus alimentos, alguien habrá pensado que lo que venga de regalo es bueno, pero yo, como médica pediatra y dedicada a la nutrición infantil, lo que pretendo para los chicos es que los chicos reciban lo que necesitan, no lo que venga de regalo.
Le pongo menos carne y lo completo con soja, mitad y mitad.
The government runs no controls for the soya provided, nor as to what is done with the soya. Meanwhile, the people who work at the dining centers try to mitigate the hunger with the same transgenic soya exported as food for pigs and poultry.
Y tratamos de hablar a la gente que se preocupa por la pobreza, por la indigencia, por el hambre de los niños, que no acepten esta soja transgénica que están donando los productores y los exportadores, porque es una especie de precio, es una especie de chantaje que están ellos dando para que el país acepte el modelo. Y lo que hay que desmontar es el modelo.
Nutritional and environmental safety of transgenic elements is under suspicion. Every day, there are new debates on the subject. Many countries refuse to open their borders to the sowing and human consumption of transgenic food, waiting for scientific evidence to prove these products innocuous. Multinational companies defend transgenic organisms, arguing they are going to solve the hunger problem worldwide.
El argumento de paliar el hambre en el mundo, dar solución al hambre en el mundo, realmente es un argumento vil. En realidad este es un argumento que no se tendría que utilizar más, ni en favor ni en contra de esto, porque detrás de esto hay gente que en realidad está pasando hambre y está muriendo por esta consecuencia.
But large corporations do not care about the argument used when it comes to selling their products and getting higher yields. Agriculturists, such as Ugo Nussiari, make the most of the economic benefits from growing soya. They make a lot of money, but are becoming more and more dependent on transnational firms. Besides from buying huge amounts of glyphosate to fumigate the crop, they must buy the seeds and pay a high industrial patent.
El fenómeno de la soja transgénica, que está hecho por una multinacional americana, que desarrolló la soja transgénica en función de sus negocios, no de los intereses del agro argentino. Entonces la hicieron para vender el tipo de herbicida que a ellos les interesa. Entonces armaron un paquete de negocios en que ellos venden la semilla de soja junto con su herbicida y con su producto. Y esto está muy bien para ellos porque optimizan su negocio. Pero no está bien para la Argentina, porque en la Argentina nadie optimiza su negocio, sino que contribuye a optimizar el negocio de una firma extranjera.
Soya produces foreign currency for Argentina. In 2003, a gross income of almost $6.5 billion was attained. But the economic growth produced by the soya is not going hand in hand with the balanced industrial and social growth. It is exclusively based on producing raw materials for export.
Si la soja sale del campo y va derecho al puerto y se porta como tal, o va a una planta aceitera que la procesa de manera muy simple y sale como aceite. No hay mucho empleo. No hay mucha actividad industrial, no se puede hacer otra cosa, ¿no? Entonces, esto no es una actividad para la Argentina. ¿Vea? Puede haber incrementos de la producción agraria argentina, incrementos de la producción de soja, con millones de desocupados.
The food programs and economic assistance for the jobless and the poor use an important part of the taxes on soya exports. The lack of adequate policies result in that the economic benefits obtained by Argentina do not promote its growth or create new jobs. Furthermore, the genetic changes do not add to soya any nutritional or medical value that might favor consumers. The firm Monsanto aimed at creating and obtaining the patent of a kind of soya resistant to glyphosate, of which it is also the patent holder. Its target, surpassed significantly, was commercial with no humanitarian aim. Transgenic soya is cheaper to produce than ordinary soya, and as both cost the same, it has a higher yield. But its transgenic condition can bring commercial problems in the future, due to the non-assessed risks as to its consumption and crops.
No se probó que haga daño, pero tampoco se probó que no lo haga. Y esto hace que muchos países no quieran comprar soja transgénica. Si el precio es el mismo, ¿por qué no van a comprar soja natural en lugar de comprar soja transgénica? Entonces nosotros pensamos que lo que va a ocurrir en determinado momento es que finalmente la soja transgénica que está haciendo la Argentina se va a empezar a cotizar a menor valor que la natural, porque dado que hay un riesgo para el consumidor y ninguna ventaja, la única razón de que la compre es que la pague menos. Con lo cual perderíamos la ventaja que tenemos porque tiene menos costo. Entonces estamos entrando en un negocio donde perdemos el control del paquete tecnológico y donde seguramente vamos a también perder rentabilidad debido a esta diferencia entre la soja transgénica y la soja natural.
Monsanto and the other seed producers are determined to expand the soya crops in Argentina. It's a perfect deal for these companies. They create new transgenic products and make the corresponding agrochemicals, and they also run most of Argentina's grain exports. In this way, they have full control over the soya business.
Más aún todavía, los exportadores en la Argentina no entregan las divisas. Las divisas son negociadas en el mercado internacional, no vuelven al país. ¿Comprende? Entonces se ha denunciado en los periódicos esta trampa de que todo el país trabaja para los productores de soja exportan esta soja y las divisas no vuelven al país, se quedan jugando en el mercado internacional. Entonces es como una hemorragia, ¿viste? Que hay que cortarla, ¿no?
The soya business is increasingly benefiting fewer and fewer people, destroying the soil, the environment and employment. The farmers and the company's greed and the government's absolute indifference seem to matter more than the scientific, environmental, and social concern.
El modelo agrícola al que nosotros nos enfrentamos no es sustentable en términos sociales, en términos económicos, en términos ambientales. Es decir, podemos tener alguna solución coyuntural actual por una relación de buenos precios internacionales, pero esta situación no va a seguir en el futuro, es imposible que esto suceda.
The government expects to increase the area cultivated with soya to 5 million hectares, harvesting benefits of its own. The taxes on soya exports will continue supplying food assistance to a growing population of unemployed, and also paying the huge interest of the Argentine foreign debt. The forest in the Chaco region and the biodiversity will keep on dying out, while companies and farmers increase their yields. For the last decade, Argentina has been living an unprecedented agricultural transformation, one that has traded quality for quantity, jobs for technology, nutritional safety for technological dependence. Argentine farming has turned into an industrial agriculture that additionally depends on industry at the expense of the hunger of its people, of environmental damage, and of economic and social development, a development that is further and further away.